Chapter 5, The Awkward Age. Finding employment was surprisingly easy. Young Newbert people were in demand as Britain's budding technology industry broadened their ambitions and their markets. Within weeks of leaving school, I had two interviews, both in northwest London, and shortly afterwards, two job offers. Both involved being a junior research assistant. One was for the General Electric Company, GEC, in Wembley. The other was at the Post Office Research Station in Dollis Hill. GEC paid slightly better, but they said plainly that they had no interest in helping me to pursue further studies, whereas the Post Office Research Station was interested in my further development and was prepared to arrange my hours to allow further study. So I signed up with the Post Office and shortly afterwards enrolled for evening classes in applied mathematics and later physics at Sir John Cass College in Moorgate, now the Sir John Cass College of Science and Technology. So began a strange period in my life, a time of development and turmoil in which I didn't really seem to be going anywhere, and yet in some important sense was metamorphosing into my true adult self. Now that I look back on them, those ostensibly becalmed years in my late teens and early 20s seem faintly surreal. Yet they were critical to the shaping of my career. I suspect that such directionless periods form part of most working lives. What determines our future is how we respond to the frustrations. I began by living with my mother. Shortly after we were naturalised, she had bought a small house in Colindale, also in northwest London, borrowing the money for a deposit from some German emigre friends and taking in lodgers to help pay for it. One of the lodgers had helped me get my two job interviews. She was now working as a teacher and, with her marriage behind her, was reclaiming control of her life. But we constantly rubbed each other up the wrong way, and so, as soon as I could, I began to rent a bedsit of my own in Cricklewood. It was an attic room in a tall Victorian house in a wide tree-lined road called Warm Lane, with a bustling, bossy, very Jewish landlady called Mrs. Cohen, five other lodgers, and a shared bathroom. Even by the standards of the day, it was far from luxurious, yet it felt wonderfully independent. I used to leave early, six mornings a week, to catch the bus to Dollis Hill. Saturday was a half day, and often didn't get home until 10 p.m. if I had an evening class, which generally happened three times a week. There was also studying to be done at weekends, so there wasn't much time to worry about my living conditions. I learnt to look after myself, to cook after a fashion in an oven without a thermostat, to make and mend things, and above all, to be organised. Long-term existence in a bedsit is tolerable when all the surfaces are clear, but the space closes in on you horribly if you let it get cluttered. Luckily, I didn't have many possessions to keep tidy. My annual salary, £215, seemed enough for my needs. I had grown used to living carefully. The monthly pay packet, about £14 after tax, included one crisp white £5 note, which I always tried, in vain, not to spend. Most of the money went on rent and travel, and a stupid habit that I had for some reason decided to acquire, smoking. I was careful. I would walk part of the way to work rather than pay an extra stage of the bus fare. I often ran out of money before payday, and on one occasion I went without food for so long that I passed out. But I wasn't conscious of being poor in the way that I had been in Oswestry. Not least for the first time in years, I wasn't dependent on anyone else's charity. Cricklewood seemed a cheerful place, with lots of Jewish and Irish people and a few early Jamaicans. It felt lively but safe, unless you walked down Cricklewood Broadway at pub throwing out time, and I was glad to live there. Compared with the rural England I had known thus far, northwest London buzzed with cosmopolitan sophistication. My work at the post office was menial. As a research assistant, I was there to perform routine or tiresome tasks for proper researchers. A lot of it was mere arithmetic, drawing graphs or slogging through repetitive calculations or tables to try out ideas, or banging figures through a comptometer, a kind of electromechanical adding machine that was effectively a primitive calculator, to make statistical inferences or to work out probabilities. The subject matter varied. One day we'd be helping some near genius with pioneering work on, say, telephony. The next we'd be doing tedious sums connected with the postal service. I remember once having to analyse the number of strands in a piece of string from a ball found in a suspected thief's shed to see if, statistically, it matched with the string of a stolen parcel. It was unexciting, but strangely satisfying. You knew exactly what your work was and whether or not it was done and whether or not it had been done well, which it had to be. And I, at least, felt that there was some purpose to it. There were four of us, all in our late teens, all working on similar tasks in the same little block of desks. For about a year, we called each other Miss Brooke, Miss French, Mr. Hodges, and so on. And then, daringly, someone suggested, when nobody's here, shall we use first names? So we did. But we never really became good friends. The nature of the work wasn't conducive to casual chat. One of the highest priorities was to have a completely clear desk at the end of each day. Apparently this was for security reasons. Our immediate boss was a very staid, buttoned-up Scotsman called Ettrick Thompson, who shared an office with three other senior people, one of whom was his boss, a bad-tempered, reclusive man called H.J. Josephs, who had a chip on his shoulder about being self-taught and who dealt with his insecurities by trying to make his junior employees cry. He never quite succeeded with me, but came close several times. What saved me was the discovery that as my evening classes expanded my mathematical education, I was beginning to understand many concepts better than he did, and could make him back off simply by speaking confidently about whatever subject he was picking us up on. Yet for all his unpleasantness, he had a passion for his subject, a sense of its beauty, and a general yearning for excellence. It was hard not to be inspired by this, and in a strange way, I think he was a good influence on me. I also had a more distant boss, Mr. Joseph's superior, Doc Jarvis, who was notable for having appalling handwriting, like a doctor's. No one dared go back and ask him what his scrawled memos meant, and so one of my tasks was to decipher them by sheer force of logic. For example, this must be a D, because he always starts with dear, and so this must be a D too. Well, that must be another E, and so on. In a sense, this was fitting. Deciphering had an honoured place in Dollis Hill's intellectual traditions. Workers at the research station, which had opened in 1933, had built the world's first programmable electronic computer, the Colossus 1, in 1943. This was used, along with nine Colossus IIs built the following year, by the code-breaking team at Bletchley Park that cracked the Nazis' supposedly indecipherable Enigma code, and its even more opaque successor, the teleprinter code, known as Lorentz or Fish. There were people still working at Dollis Hill in the early 1950s, Tommy Flowers and Alan Doc Coombs, who were the most senior, who had played a pivotal role in the wartime work of Bletchley Park, which in turn had been crucial to the Allied victory. The Colossus II, Tommy Flowers' brainchild, provided vital decrypt information on the eve of D-Day, days after its delivery from Dollis Hill to Bletchley Park. No one spoke about this at the time. People still took the Official Secrets Act very seriously. Even Tommy Flowers' family didn't learn about his war work until 1970. But we had a vague sense that this unassuming man had done something important. And in the meantime, it was clear that his area of expertise, essentially the development of very early computers into recognisably modern computers through the pioneering use of thermionic valves, tubes, rather than electromechanical switches, was close to some of the widest frontiers of human knowledge. The current aims were relatively mundane, developing the first electronic telephone exchanges for the Joint Electronic Research Council. or, something I would later be involved in, developing ERNIE, the electronic random number indicator equipment used to pick premium bond numbers. But there was still an exciting sense of being at the forefront of new technology, especially at those points where work edged into territory that would nowadays be known as computing. At some stage, after a year or so of evening classes, it began to dawn on me that while I loved the beauty of maths and could master it to a fairly high level, and began to study for a bachelor's degree in mathematics as soon as I had obtained the matriculation requirements, I was never going to become the world's greatest mathematician. This might have been disillusioning had I not more or less simultaneously fallen in love with computers. It was a good time to do so. On the one hand, some of the most brilliant minds of the day were developing the field. On the other, the technology was still sufficiently basic for a mind like mine, clever but not genius material, to be able to grasp the problems involved, if not to deduce the solutions. The mechanical calculator on which I churned out my boring calculations was so basic that it hardly deserves to be called a precursor of the modern computer. Yet even I could sense, intuitively, that with sufficient brain power, this simple concept could evolve into an unimaginably powerful computing device. It was a bit like being in at the birth of, say, American democracy. First principles were being laid down and tested as the twin streams of automated calculation and programming converged to make what had hitherto been a boffin's fantasy, high-powered artificial intelligence, a tantalizing, achievable possibility. I had no idea how the next breakthroughs would be achieved, but the evolution of technologies to date, punch tape, punched cards, thermionic valves, transistors, was perfectly comprehensible to me. And I sensed, correctly, that when the history of computing came to be written, several of its early chapters would be set in Dollis Hill in the early 1950s. All of this made my work seem rather less banal than many first jobs. I was growing used to the disciplines of work, doing things in an orderly, reliable way, keeping records, putting personal moods and problems to one side, and I could see the value of doing so. The calculations entrusted to me were growing gradually more challenging, and if I did sometimes balk at remaining an insignificant drone in the great scheme of things, well, I was also young, and there were other things in my life. I might, however, have been pushed to say honestly what those other things were. Yes, there were my studies, in which I took a keen or arguably excessive interest, partly because they were inherently interesting, but also because of a neurotic obsession with doing as well as I possibly could in exams. I enjoyed those early evening journeys across London, eagerly anticipating each evening class, though I never quite adjusted to the fact that some colleges had no women's toilets. And heading back to Cricklewood later on, I would feel my eyes drooping with satisfied exhaustion. But even the most serious-minded young woman cannot work all the time, and gradually, as London grew less strange, I became aware of empty spaces in my life. Some were filled simply with loneliness, others by staying in fairly frequent touch with aunt and uncle. I also made occasional weekend visits to some friends of my mother's, the Sampsons, who'd known my parents from Dortmund but had got out with their wealth intact in 1933. They lived in Edgware and were kind in a very serious sort of way. Helen Sampson was a dentist. I still have the gold fillings she gave me as birthday presents. The Sampsons introduced me to the refugee circles in which they moved, for which I should have been grateful. But I felt stiflingly bored in the company of people who talked only of what they'd left behind. I also had a phase, also suggested by the Sampsons, I think, of working as a volunteer serving drinks on a charity barge on the Regent's Canal, not from any altruistic motives, but as a way of meeting people. Then, as I developed a sense of myself as an independent adult, I began to feel that I was too grown up for that sort of thing. The result was that I spent less time with the Sampsons and their contacts without meeting anyone else. Sometimes I went all the way from Saturday lunchtime to Monday morning without speaking to another human being. At other times, the emptiness was filled with a series of rather pointless love affairs with a succession of not very suitable young men, whom I met, usually via work or college. I look back today on this period of promiscuity with a combination of embarrassment, all those floorboard creaking tiptoed departures late at night, and pity for my former self. I suppose it was a fairly predictable response to the lack of human warmth in my life, and a not uncommon way for an insecure young woman to create a sense of identity and self-worth. In a sense, I was discovering who I was. It was interesting in this context that on one occasion in this period, my father sent me a letter using my old name. "Do you know anyone called Buchtal?" Mrs. Cohn asked when I came home. "No," I said, and I'd climbed two flights of stairs before I realised my mistake. The cumulative effect of these experiences was neither escape nor self-confidence, but instead increasing misery. I became jumpy and anxiety-prone, and I often felt paralysed with terror on my late-night walks back from the bus stop. Such fears were not entirely unreasonable, especially in those impenetrable pea-super autumn fogs that still plagued London before the 1956 Clean Air Act. There was almost an assumption in those days that an unaccompanied woman who bumped into a man on such conditions would be raped. I dealt with this by learning some basic self-defense skills, which boosted my confidence a little. It's always reassuring to know how to knee a man in the groin. But the broader, less specific anxiety continued to gnaw away at my life. Everyone else seemed to have roots where I was just an exile, an outsider. The sound of Viennese music would reduce me to tears, and then increasingly would all sorts of things, including the most mundane setbacks in everyday life. I began to fear that I would never be at peace again. Eventually, I sought medical help. The doctor, a Jewish emigre, prescribed me Dexamil, the notorious amphetamine-based antidepressant better known, especially by US servicemen, as Purple Hearts. At first, I would take one only if I felt especially bad. Then whenever I felt I needed help to get through a particularly difficult day, and then to get me through just about any day, in case it was difficult. Eventually, I was taking them most evenings as well, just to get me through the night. These were bleak times, and of course there was no question of sharing my troubles with either my colleagues or my family. At least once, I seriously contemplated putting my head in the oven. If the oven hadn't been so filthy, I think I might have gone through with it, but it seemed ridiculous to clean the oven just in order to commit suicide. Instead, I finally told a little of what I was going through to one of my ex-lovers, who was perceptive enough to suggest that there was an underlying cause to all this insecurity and all these failed affairs, that I was, in effect, choosing unsuitable partners in order to set myself up for rejection, for reasons that probably lay buried in my past. He also persuaded me, with difficulty, to sign up for some psychoanalysis at the Tavistock Clinic, the pioneering therapeutic unit in Marylebone that had recently begun to specialise in family dynamics. Some people sneer when this kind of thing is mentioned. They're welcome to their cynicism. For me, it was a godsend. A few tentative sessions with a Jungian therapist called Dr. Ezrael turned into a sustained course of regular analysis lasting 6 years, in the course of which I became aware of various issues that now seem so obvious to me that I cannot imagine how I ever managed to bury them. For example, I felt rejected by my mother, who had not only sent me away on the kinder transport, but had also chosen to be reunited with Renata in preference to me. I felt rejected by my father, who not only sent me away, but had subsequently abandoned me, along with the rest of his family, a second time. And I felt devalued by the chronic sense, going back to my very earliest memories, that I was displeasing to my mother. The fact that the Nazis had wanted to kill me hadn't done wonders for my self-esteem either. I had known all this for years, of course. What I had buried was the pain. My conscious mind had focused on the positive side of my story, how lucky I had been to escape the Nazis and to be shown such kindness by my foster family and my adopted country, whose NHS, I noted with grateful amazement, was now providing me with this psychoanalysis. Perhaps as a result, I'd never thought clearly about how much certain things had hurt me. I had resented my mother's constant criticisms and disapproved of my father's undutiful conduct towards his family. But I'd never focused on what these things had done to me and to the unhealed child within me. Now that I was finally doing so, I was able to consider my feelings rationally. I could see on the one hand that there was nothing to be ashamed of in having been hurt, but also on the other, that most of these rejections were no reflection on me. I had been sent away because of Hitler's cruelty, not because of my own failings. And if I irritated and disappointed my mother, that was largely because of the failure of her marriage rather than my shortcomings as a child. I still felt pain, of course I did. But I also had a choice now between letting this pain control my life and leaving it behind. I resolved eventually to leave it behind. In the same way, psychoanalysis taught me to look differently at another issue that had been eating away at me, survivor guilt. I don't know if I'd ever explicitly formulated the thought that I was undeserving of life when so many millions of others had had life stolen from them. But now that I looked in on myself, I realised that this idea underlay much of my long-term unease. Now I turned a more forgiving light on the issue. Yes, I'd been lucky, astonishingly so. But my luck was no more undeserved than it was deserved. It was not my fault. Rather than agonising forever over the unanswerable question, why me, I could choose to make more positive use of my luck. In other words, I would make the most of the life that had been vouchsafed to me and make each day count so that my life would have been worth saving. I mention all this partly because it was a significant stage in my personal evolution, but also because it explains why these early years of my career were, in general, uneventful. By the time I'd fitted in my evening classes, my initial studies in advanced mathematics and physics were followed by a four-year degree course at Sir John Cass College, and after that a further one-year stint working studying computer logic at Birkbeck College. And my therapy, initially three times a week, but later just once a week, there was little time left to do much else except work and sleep. It also gives a hint, I think, of how the shadow of war still lingered over 1950s Britain. Compared with tens of millions of fellow Europeans, I'd been all but unscathed, yet even I was still traumatised by the conflict's destructive effects. If people in general were a little numb and withdrawn in the way they worked and lived, it was hardly surprising. But things could have been worse, and in my increasingly frequent moments of maturity, I began to develop a sense of contentment. Yet it was all too easy to slip back into a sense of aggrievement and frustration, especially in the early days of my therapy. This was partly because I was beginning to suspect that my progress at work was being hampered by prejudice. My evening classes had raised me from the bottom of Dollis Hill's intellectual food chain. I was now sufficiently qualified to start studying for a bachelor's degree, and I began to look out for a less menial position. A vacancy for an assistant experimental officer, the next grade up, was advertised internally, and I asked Edric Thompson to put me up for it. He looked awkward and, without explanation, refused. I felt initially crushed. It took me some time before it occurred to me that the most likely explanation for his refusal was my gender. Undeterred, I found a public version of the advertisement, published in the New Statesman, I think, and applied anyway. I was interviewed and in due course appointed. Edric Thompson never forgave me. I suppose this must have meant that I was growing more confident, or at least behaving in a way that suggested greater confidence. I was scarcely out of my teens, but perhaps my fractured upbringing had given me a sense that if I wanted to make anything of my life, I needed to take control of it myself. It didn't surprise me at all, in retrospect, that some people saw me as pushy. A kinder analysis would be to say that Like all refugees, I had been forced to develop a strong sense of independence. I was certainly independent in my lifestyle by the standards of the day, setting my own agenda rather than being at somebody else's beck and call. I kept in touch with my mother sporadically, by phone, but hardly at all with my father, whose new wife, Maria, wanted as little to do with his previous family as possible. I exchanged regular and warm letters with Renata, who was by now settled in Sydney, where she in due course became an admired social worker specialising in the care of traumatised children. But the physical distance between us prevented us from playing major day-to-day roles in one another's lives. I also kept in touch with auntie and uncle and still paid them occasional visits when time permitted. But I had by now begun to look rather disdainfully, with my young woman's arrogance, upon what I saw as their parochial outlook, and as the years passed, time permitted less often. Instead, the main focus of my life outside work became Warm Lane, where I gradually settled into more mature habits and began, for example, to give embryonic dinner parties in my little bedsit. I even organised, towards the end of my third year in London, a small 21st birthday party for myself. This was attended by a number of family friends as well as younger colleagues from work and college. There was also an older man present called Trevor Atwell, who was at that stage my boyfriend. This was the most important of my various premarital relationships and the longest lasting. Trevor was much older than me and married, and in almost every respect unsuitable. Later, when I'd untangled some of my subconscious knots, the attraction was obvious. My father had rejected me. My mother had always been criticising me for being immature, an excusable failing, one might think, in a child. What could be a better way of answering them than to be the loved one of a successful older man? The affair lasted for several years, on and off, and was sufficiently serious for me to be cited as co-respondent in Trevor's divorce. I'm not sure that I was the cause of it. He'd been separated from his wife before he met me, and there were faults on the other side as well. But convention dictated that the man should be the guilty party. And so, according to the sordid custom of the day, we spent a weekend at a hotel in Brighton where, by prior arrangement, the hotelier served us breakfast in bed so that he could later testify in court to Trevor's infidelity. I relate this not because I'm proud of any of it, but because it must say something about the kind of person I am and how I became who I am. I also have a vivid memory of how, many months later, the relationship ended. Trevor was divorced by then and was hoping that we could start a new life together. I remember feeling a mounting sense of panic as this prospect grew more real and realising with increasing certainty that this wasn't what I wanted at all. I liked Trevor and enjoyed being with him. But the longer we spent together, the more I realised that I was still developing while he was not. He was happy with his place in the world, whereas I wanted more. And while he was certainly not stupid, I knew that I was outstripping him intellectually. I had, I realised, been hiding this fact from both of us, just as I had with my previous lovers. That is what women did in those days. For years, I'd been in the habit of replying if a man asked me what I did for a living, that I worked for the post office, hoping he would think I sold stamps or something, rather than admitting to working with my brain at the internationally admired Dollis Hill Research Station. But now, when it came to a decision that would define who I was for the rest of my life, I realised I could no longer go along with this kind of self-effacement. I had to stop playing a part, to stop playing down those very qualities that made me who I was, my intellect and my curiosity and my restless drive to have an impact on the world. It was one thing to pretend to be someone else in order to fall in with a man's understanding of what a girlfriend's role should be, and thus to oil the wheels of a relationship in the short term. It was a very different thing to build my whole life on that pretense. I realised with shocking clarity that if I wanted more from life, I would have to go out and insist on it, irrespective of any challenges this posed to received notions of femininity, that meant moving on from the whole idea of living my life as a supporting role in somebody else's drama, whether it was Trevor's or anyone else's. Perhaps I'd finally grown up. From now on, I decided I would be my own person. I would stop apologising for myself, stop hiding myself, and while I was at it, stop feeling sorry for myself. I wanted whatever talents I had to be fully used, and the only person who was going to make that happen was me. I also resolved that I would stop congratulating myself on the little I had achieved in my life so far. Resting on one's laurels is the surest route to stagnation. Instead, I would keep aiming higher and higher, giving free rein to my instinct to ask restlessly, is that all there is? If I failed, so be it. But I would never allow myself to get into a position where I would curse myself for not having tried. I've not always succeeded in sticking to these resolutions, but more than half a century later, I'm tempted to say that they have defined my life.